Although we've looked at how to draw the Lewis structures of individual elements and ions in previous videos, the purpose of this video will be to show how Lewis structures are used to represent compounds, meaning substances that contain multiple atoms, specifically ionic compounds in this video. Now, the key difference of Lewis structures of compounds compared to individual elements is that the primary purpose of Lewis structures is to show how multiple elements are bonded to one another, and in ionic compounds, this is done by highlighting the charge, because again, it is the attraction between the positive and negative charges of ions that hold multiple ions together. The good news is that all of the details of the Lewis structures of individual atoms are identical to those of compounds, in that Lewis structures only show three pieces of information, the first of which being the chemical symbol in order to identify the element, as we can see with potassium and chlorine in this Lewis structure here. The second detail that is absent in the Lewis structures of individual elements are what we call bonds, which again are the attractive forces that hold the compound together. In ionic compounds, these bonds are represented by the charges of each of the ions, because once again, this attractive force between charges allows the compound to hold itself together. And finally, unlike Bohr-Rutherford diagrams, the only electrons that are shown in Lewis structures of atoms and ions are, of course, the valence electrons. Now, when learning the individual steps for drawing the Lewis structures of compounds, it's actually easiest to use examples so that we can follow along with what the steps are. So we're going to use two contrasting examples, aluminum fluoride and potassium oxide here. So the first step with any ionic compound, or actually any compound at all, is to draw the atoms that make up each of the individual compounds and count the total number of valence electrons so that we see what we are dealing with. And in ionic compounds, the ultimate purpose of counting the valence electrons is to ultimately consider what the charges are going to be for each of the ions that are formed. So if we go to our periodic table, we're looking for four elements: aluminum, fluorine, potassium, and oxygen. So we can see aluminum here is in group 3A, meaning it has three valence electrons. Potassium, we've seen already, is in group 1A, so it will have one. Fluorine is a halogen, meaning it is in group 7A, so it will have seven valence electrons. And oxygen right next to it in group 6A will have six valence electrons. So if we represent these, aluminum, and we don't really need to write fluorine three times, we just need to keep in mind how many fluorines there are. And it's always good practice to start an electron count. So fluorine has seven valence electrons, seven times three is 21, and aluminum has three valence electrons, 21 plus three is a total of 24 electrons that this aluminum fluoride compound will contain. Likewise, with potassium oxide, we don't really need to draw two potassiums out yet. We can just indicate that there are two of them, each of which with one valence electron, and oxygen, of course, has six valence electrons. So with our electron count, six electrons from oxygen and two electrons from two potassiums is a total of eight valence electrons that we're dealing with. Now that we have all of this information here, the next thing we need to determine is what the central atom of the compound is going to be. And the central atom is easy to determine because this is always going to be the atom with what we call the most unpaired valence electrons. So what is meant by an unpaired electron? Well, this is easiest to see with potassium because it only has one. So because it only has one electron, it is impossible for potassium to have a paired electron. So we can say that potassium has one unpaired, if I can spell that correctly. Oxygen, however, has two unpaired electrons, but these electrons here, because these exist as lone pairs, because they already exist in pairs of electrons, these are not considered unpaired. So oxygen, by contrast, will have two unpaired, let's write that more neatly there, oxygen will have two unpaired electrons, and because oxygen has more unpaired electrons than potassium does, we are going to designate it as our central atom, and we can write it like this, with the two potassium atoms around it like this. If we do the same procedure for aluminum and fluorine, we can see very obviously that aluminum has three electrons, all of which are unpaired, whereas fluorine only has one, because the other six of its electrons already exist in lone pairs, and therefore aluminum is going to be our central atom, so we can put this in the center with the three fluorines around it, like so. For those of you that are particular about locations, does the second fluorine need to be below the aluminum? No, and you will see why. So now that we have the general arrangement of atoms in each of our compounds, the next thing that we need to do, because we are working with ionic compounds, is to turn each of the atoms in the compound into an ion, which means that we need to look at the Lewis structures of each of them and determine which elements are going to lose electrons and which elements are going to gain electrons in order to attain the goal of a full valence shell. So with aluminum here, because losing three electrons is easier than gaining five, aluminum is going to lose three, and that's a good coincidence because we have three fluorines, and each fluorine wants to gain one electron, so each electron that aluminum gives away will be picked up by one fluorine, and we can give each of the three fluorines here a full valence shell, like so. And because aluminum lost its three electrons, we don't need to write anything at all. And if we check our count of electrons, each of the fluorines has 8. 8 plus 8 is 16, plus 8 is 24 electrons, which means we have no electrons left over. So our electrons are all accounted for in aluminum fluoride. If we try this with potassium oxide, this is even easier because each potassium we know is going to lose its electron because losing one is easier than gaining seven. And because we have two potassiums, that means that each potassium is going to give its electron to oxygen so that oxygen gains two, giving oxygen a full valence shell like so. And of course, because potassium has lost its valence electron, we don't write the electron in either of its structures. And if we check our electron count, there should be 8 electrons in total. Oxygen has a full valence shell of 8, meaning we have no electrons left over, which is exactly what we expect to see. Now, normally we'd be done here, except remember that we are dealing with ionic compounds, so therefore we need to add square brackets to each of our elements to indicate that each of them has a full valence shell, and then of course we need to designate what the charge is depending on how many electrons have been gained or lost. So if we do that, starting with each of the fluorines here, because each fluorine has gained one electron, this is the equivalent of adding a negative one charge. So we add a negative one charge to each of our fluorines like this. And with aluminum here, we put square brackets around it like this. And because aluminum has lost three electrons, this is the same thing as removing a negative three charge, or otherwise known as adding a positive 3 charge. And if we check the total charge of this compound here, a positive 3 charge from aluminum minus 3, because each fluorine has a negative 1 charge, and negative 1 times 3 is negative 3. Positive 3 minus 3 is 0, which is a neutral charge, and so we are good for the structure of aluminum fluoride. And with potassium oxide, we go with the same procedure. We can add square brackets around the oxygen here. And because oxygen has gained 2 electrons, this is the equivalent of adding a -2 charge, which we indicate like so. And then with each of the potassiums, we can add square brackets. And because potassium has lost 1 electron, removing a -1 charge is the same as adding a +1 charge. And if we check that our charges have all added up, we have a +2 charge from the 2 potassiums together, subtract the charge of -2 from oxygen, +2 - 2 is an overall charge of 0, meaning that our compound is neutral and both of our Lewis structures are done. Now, previously, I had said that if you wanted to put this fluorine up here, for example, that would be equally acceptable, because remember, the whole point of drawing structures of ionic compounds is to show that it is the charge interaction that holds the compound together. So as long as the +3 charge of aluminum is next to the -1 charges of fluorine, it doesn't really matter where you put the fluorines, as long as the positive and negative charges are next to each other, so that we can show the attraction. And likewise for the 2 potassiums here. If you wanted to put this potassium down here, that structure is perfectly acceptable because it still shows that the positive and negative charges are attracting to one another and holding the compound together. Now, before you move on to the last topic in our series on ionic compounds, you can try the practice problems below, in which you will need to identify the number of valence electrons that the metal and non-metal have in each of these ionic compounds here, figure out the central atom, and draw the appropriate Lewis structure following the steps that we did above here. And once you are confident in your ability to draw ionic Lewis structures, you can move on to the final topic in this video series, which is understanding how the naming system for ionic compounds works.